Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General McNabb, General Hamm, thank you for your service to our country. General Hamm, as a combatant commander and as a general proposition, do you think that it is important before the United States intervenes militarily that there be a clear mission, that the mission be authorized by Congress, and that that mission have the support of the American people?
Senator, absolutely, we have to have a clear mission. I would have to leave it to others about the second part of your question, but certainly it is preferable always to have the support of the Congress and certainly the support of the people as represented by the Congress.
Well, General, I thank you for your answer. It wasn't just supposed to be a trick question. It strikes me that we've learned from sad experience what happens when the United States gets involved or stays involved in a military conflict where public support and support from Congress wanes in terms of its impact on our success of accomplishing the mission. Let me move on, though, to the question of intelligence. It strikes me as unusual and maybe something that Congress needs to look at further, that our intelligence capabilities are so limited that we don't even know the composition of the opposition force in Libya, and I'm just using that as one example, before we intervene militarily, and that because we are in doubt about the composition of that opposition force, that we are constrained from equipping them or providing them with access to the resources they may need in order to accomplish our goal and their goal at the same time. Is this unusual in your experience, or is this common?
I would describe it as unique, in at least in my experience, of not having a clear understanding of who the opposition forces were. Senator, I would also, it is also important to remember that that our mission was not to support the opposition, but rather to protect civilians. Now, certainly, in the protection of civilians, there was some obvious benefit to the opposition forces when we would do that. But it was a distinction in my mind of the purpose of the mission.
Well, to protect the civilians in Libya, there's been a lot of discussion about whether we should arm the opposition forces or the rebels. And I'm entirely sympathetic to your concerns and that those expressed by others that we don't want to arm them if we don't know who they are and what they might become. But it strikes me as very strange and certainly a deficiency in our intelligence capability if we've intervened in a military action, even for humanitarian purposes, and we don't know who the opposition is, so we are thus constrained from going further and giving them the resources they need in order to win and expel Gaddafi from power. But let me ask you another question. What sort of signal does it send to our other adversaries in the region, notably Iran and others, for us to intervene militarily and fail to accomplish a regime change in Libya, whether it be by military or political means? Does it strike you as a sign of weakness or lack of American resolve or inadequacy of planning that we would actually go to this far and yet not accomplish or seem ambivalent about accomplishing regime change?
Sure, I would say again, I'd come back to the first part, which was the execution of the military mission to protect civilians, establish no-fly zone embargo, which I think was successful, and I think a message to others around the world is the speed with which that was accomplished was pretty significant. I don't think people should misunderstand a policy decision that says it is the policy for there to be regime change, but to seek that through means other than military. I don't think people should misunderstand the lack of seriousness which that means. We certainly could use military force, but again, we have some history in trying to apply military force to regime change where we have been less than successful.
Yes, General, it's not your responsibility or your fault, but I go back to my initial questions with regard to clarity of mission, support from Congress, and support from the American people. And any ambiguity, it seems to me, in any of those things would seem to me to give you less than the kind of support you need in order to accomplish that mission, whatever it may be. Let me move on to ask about, there's been questions, I think, Senator Lieberman, Senator McCain, about the A-10s and the AC-130s, which you said are unique American capabilities. I think you and Secretary Gates and Admiral Mullen all said that these are available, although they're unique American capabilities, they are available to NATO if they request them. To your knowledge, have they been requested?
Yes, sir, they have, and they have been provided.
They have been. They have been. They're currently being deployed in the fight?
Sir, I don't. The AC-130s, I believe, are currently available. I believe the A-10s are currently available on request.
Okay. So the AC-130s are in the fight now?
I think they are. My last understanding is that they are available to the commander should he want them.
Okay. And then finally, let me ask, General, the I think there's an impression, a mistaken impression, that by the U.S. initiating this fight and then handing it off to Libya, it's somehow handing it off to a third party that does not necessarily, that is not the United States. But the truth is that NATO could not function as a fighting force without the U.S. support, could it?
So the Supreme Allied Commander is a U.S. officer. Much of the military capability that enables the current operation is provided by the United States.
And one of the perennial problems in NATO is that our allies do not resource either funding or in terms of personnel their military requirements like the United States. The United States spends more on our national security than I think the next 22 nations in a row. In other words, the United States is the biggest and most powerful nation as part of that coalition. Wouldn't you agree?
Sure, I would. The contributions of other nations have been significant and very important, but certainly the United States has provided to this point the preponderance of military force.
And that includes, as Senator Begich asked, the obligation as part of that NATO coalition to fund operations at whatever level is required by our agreements with NATO.
Sir, my understanding is that NATO contributions are currently funded by the individual states, I'm not a NATO expert, but I'm not sure that NATO common funding is being applied.
I certainly understand and appreciate that. You've been very good about answering my questions. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Cornyn. Senator Hagan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and